Must to Die is one of the most prophetic pieces on the Nettleford choreographic landscape. His burning black torso tumbling and turning without any chance of escaping the savagery of those who were always intent on hastening his demise, of the little black country boy who came to town, but they never succeeded. The Plantation Great House is the colonial cathedral that ruled the lives of the proletariat, whose labor fueled wealth and power over the masses. Ralston Milton Nettleford was born in a peasant family on the periphery of the cane field, but this little country boy always had his eyes focused on the pinnacle of excellence.
I have often said that we are all from the cane piece, and in fact, we are. Most of us are from the cane piece, and that is the basis of our legitimacy. I mean, our forebears, one or other of them, will have mixed their labor with the soil and will have built this country and other parts of the Caribbean, and that's the only basis for surviving. And you continue, and it's the artists who have helped to take us beyond survival.
He was somebody who was proud of his roots. And he was proud of the fact that he was able to achieve on the journey of his life, coming from nowhere to somewhere, from nobody to being somebody, or as he would say, somebody. He saw the person not just as a physical person. He saw the person in terms of the individual's own worth, the individual's own achievements, the individual's esteem as a whole, a totality. And that was a samadhi, because it is used in Jamaican parlance to express somebody who's greater than somebody. And that is how he looked at people.
Princes and princesses. The world is a court, and we are of royal lineage. We haven't got to make any apologies about who we are.
In the blackest night, he traveled afar in search of light. Not one for sprints, Rex always ran the marathon, leaving prints in the glow of the setting sun.
But who is the man in the mirror? Today we remove his mask to discover man of the soil, sans his university gown, and sans his dancing shoes. One person who knew Prof better than most was his longtime executive assistant, Eula Morgan.
First of all, Prof is a taskmaster. Prof is just on the go, and you have to keep up with Prof. I enjoyed every moment working with him. Everything about Prof I loved. Even though the job was hard, the task was difficult. As Prof would say, he trained Miss Morgan to do things his way. And his way I did do it. He was a man, one of the nicest human beings. Kind, humane, considerate, always thinking about others, always helping. He helped from the top to the bottom. No matter who you are, where you're from, you can come to Professor Nettleford and you're going to get support, you're going to get good advice, you're going to get help, whether financial help, emotional help, whatever kind of help, he's there to give it.
There are those who would want the world to believe that Rex's life was only defined by the campus at Mona and the proscenium arch of the dance theatre. Today we remove the mask to expose an extraordinary human being that only close friends, a few relatives and treasured confidants knew.
My history with Professor Nettleford goes back to my childhood, because Professor Nettleford's mother used to work in my grandmother's house in Mount Salem, just outside Montego Bay. So I grew up hearing about this brilliant young man who was at Cornell College. I never really met him as a kid. The first time I saw him is when I was still at Cornell College. He came back from Oxford University and came to talk to the student body. And we were all impressed by this very jet black gentleman in a gray suit, speaking very properly. It impressed all of us, and we all started trying to sound like him. But that was long ago and far away.
Glory be to our mother and daughter, and to the Holy of Holies, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be.
Professor Nettleford had many friends. When Michael Manley was alive, there was endless telephone conversation. Michael Manley did very little thing without consulting Rex.
Now, it was very close to, as a friend to Mr. Manley, and admired much what he did in terms of bringing Jamaica into the wider world, the 21st century and getting us to understand that we are really part of something much, mm-hmm. much bigger than ourselves.
He was close to Siaga from in the very early days when Siaga was doing his research down in lower parts of Kingston.
Well, he definitely wanted to demarcate the difference between Bhutuism and Bhutu. Now, the Bhutu he could embrace, but not Bhutuism, which is the conduct that goes with it, that makes it reprehensible. And he didn't embrace that, but he embraced the individual who was often referred to as a Bhutu, which is people in the culture who are at a certain level, and at the same level that he came from. So he had no reason not to want to embrace them.
There are many people in different walks of life. You share, literally became close to Portia Simpson as well. The relationship with P.J. Patterson probably goes longer than anybody else because they were at university together.
Rex and myself had a very special relationship in how we related to each other during my tenure. But among the things for which he made an indelible contribution was the whole question of the revision of our cultural modes and our recognition of certain epic moments in our life. It was he who presided over the study which led to the restoration of Emancipation Day because he thought it was very, very important for the struggle in which the majority of the Jamaican people have been engaged to be recognized.
Sam Simmons told me that he has known Rex from Rex was 21 before he actually went up to Oxford.
Improving knowledge was his primary quest. His foremost aim was to be the best. Chaucer, Dickens, Keats, and Shakespeare stimulated his brain, but left him bare.
Most called him Prof, some called him Mr. Nettleford, but those who knew him well called him Rex, plain and simple. The university was his life, but not his home. Each day he found a time to come home to his own cocoon, where he could lose himself in music, his own space and his vast collection of art.
This, of course, is a collection over time. And more recently, when I look at it, a number of things have come to mind. Clearly, they reflect a kind of totality of my own views on Jamaican art, of what it ought to do for us. For one thing, let me hasten to say, I think Jamaican art, like art anywhere, is mediated by social reality. That it speaks to the actual experience, existential or historical or ancestral, of a people collectively, even when it is being expressed through the talents of an individual, as long as that individual has been a member of that society, consciously or subconsciously.
Far away from the academic politics and the quagmire of race and closet bona, it is here at home that he led a humble life surrounded by works of art, libraries of books and all kinds of musical genres that helped to inspire him in all his creative endeavors.
His love of culture, I believe, in the case of Rex, was a love of something that gave him self-expression. Because in dance in particular, he danced himself. He wasn't just somebody who sat behind in the back room. He was a performer, and a very good performer, and a very good dancer. And out of the dance, he expressed himself. And you see from many of the items that they did in their dance repertoire, that these were things that Rex would have wanted to do.
As something of an artist in the performing arts, and therefore I was constantly looking for correspondences in other branches of the arts, things that really appealed to the very things that I felt served as source of energy for what I do in the dance, in the theater. And I think just about every painting I have on the wall, just about every bit of sculpture has carried a very special meaning in those terms.
All genres of music, from the Buro drum to Bach, Belafonte and Brubeck, to Bob, Budjo and Barris, all coursed through his veins in a creative bloodstream that triggered dancing drum beats in his heart.
This is what art is all about, you know. It's not the imitation of life merely. There's some of that. It's more than that. It's adding a dimension to the reality which is there before you that takes you beyond just what you perceive.
In true African tradition, Rex always treasured his family and friends, but none more so than his mother.
He was a mama's boy. Definitely a mama's boy. He said I reminded him of his mom. I guess probably she was very frank, outspoken, you know, that type of person I was. And Miss Morgs, you're just like my mother. I think that's, you know, and that made us have that very close relationship. He was a mama's boy. When he goes to New York to visit his mom, that's where she lived. And he keeps telling me the story that he just sat around the table one day ready to eat. And his mom would say, get up from the table and go and wash your hands. I said, Prof, in your adult stage, he said, yes, Miss Morg. I said, did you do it? Of course I did, Miss Morg. My mommy spoke.
He was extremely close with his mother. He had bought her a place in New York, an apartment in New York. He saw her regularly there. To the day she died, she still liked to dance. He would go and visit her. And he was close to other relatives. But it was his mother and his grandmother they spoke about a lot.
Woman. She knows that
His close friends are scattered across the globe, but some who were very special remained constant, like his cool friend from Cornell College, Lester Woolery.
Rex's greatest ambition and wish was to see, help black people, and also to let them be aware of the dance as a way of satisfying your desires and your wishes. He did the first dance while he was at school. At the Strand Theatre in Montego Bay. He was the director and he arranged all of that. He was in second form and I was in fourth form. And that's when he developed this talent for music and for the dance. When he was in second form, he got through his school certificate and then did the higher schools. He was so invaluable to the school that the headmaster, Norman Jackson, took him on as a lecturer after he passed the high schools. So his first big break, he lectured to some of the boys who were at school with him.
Later in life, Rex developed other lifelong friendships with persons like Sam Smith, who along with his mother became the genesis of his extended family. As part of this extended family, it was Sam's daughter Shyla who carried the urn at Rex's funeral. She, like all of Sam's four children, revered him as their Uncle Rex.
Young is my light and my salvation. So shall I be.
He was a worker. He was interested in people doing things. Whatever. But they must be doing things. And however simple or complex it might be, he saw in it something that could grow.
Ogier, Govaya, and Sherlock lit a spark, ensuring Rex was never left in the dark. History and the arts occupied his time, causing roads to beckon to a colder clime.
To me, it is ironical, but to me, the Professor Nettleford seemed to enjoy nothing but to be on the phone. People are always calling him, and he would come home, put on his casual clothes, and he would go to his room, and he would take up his phone. And he just seemed to be in his element in those days. He could be talking to a West Indian prime minister. He could be talking to a UN dignitary. Or he could be just talking to somebody like you, Lennie, which has been his friends over the year. Just ordinary chat, nothing sophisticated or in depth. But he just enjoyed talking to people.
Essentially, Prof was a country guy at heart. He loved every single Jamaican food imaginable. This is the place where he could get that food, where he could get sunshine, where he could get the humor of the people. He needs to be here on this Into This Life Pulse, because that's where he got his creativity from, and that's where his dance forms came from too.
Home cooking was always his favorite, with a distinct preference for Jamaican yard food, simmered in a blackened Dutch pot flavored over an open wood fire and lovingly prepared by his perennial housekeeper, Miss Ruby.
Miss Ruby was the housekeeper. She worked with him for me, was a student at on campus. That's Miss Ruby. They had a long, long affair. She was the cook. She cooked all his special dishes. His stamp and go, his whatever, fritters. Miss Ruby is the lady. And she played a very critical part in Professor Nettleford's life, you know? Without Miss Rube, I don't know how Prof would have managed.
The greatest diet for Rex was goggle eye fish. And it had something to do with his early years, because there were no refrigerators those days. And when you bought it, you probably paid 6 pence a pound, and you had to cook it. You had to fry it for it to last. And that was Rex's greatest love.
Behind the veneer of a constant calm, Rex would retreat to the private space of his bedroom to confront the cerebral challenges that would push him to write new historical and social tomes or create new dance works in the inner sanctum of his creative mind, oftentimes drawing inspiration from fellow artists.
This poem is old, new. This poem was copied from the Bible, your prayer book, Playboy magazines, New York Times, Reader's Digest, the CIA files, the KGB files. This poem is no secret. This poem shall be called boring, stupid, senseless. This poem is watching you trying to make sense from this poem. This poem is messing up your brains, making you want to stop listening to this poem. But you shall not stop listening to this poem. You need to know what will be said next in this poem. This poem shall disappoint you, because this poem is to be continued in your mind. In your mind. In your mind. In your mind.
Ready? Bang, 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 tiki ta tang, ka ta tiki ta, ka ta king, ka ta tiki ta, ka ta tiki ta.
Rastafarian movement itself is a marvelous expression of the use of the creative imagination, the creating of a whole ontology in our own terms or in their own terms, of a cosmology, of an epistemology, a way of knowing, a way of seeing, a way of perceiving, which is independent of the received thing of given us by colonial masters. This is the significance of the Rastafarians. Never mind the outward signs of locks and what have you and so on. These are defiant, resonant expressions which are critical to be seen and to be heard. It's the inward grace which is so important. And this is really what Garvey was about. And because he spoke to the deep social forces which have to do with the ordinary people of the region.
The space stands bare. His voice no longer fills his room, but his spirit lives on. This colonial relic speaks volumes of his journey from the coconut koya cot he slept on in Bunkers Hill to a life among kings and queens without ever forgetting his roots. Despite his universal acclaim, Nettleford never forgot his humble beginnings and always found it time to give back to those who had burning ambitions to improve their station in life.
Prof was really amazing. I can remember one day, for instance, an old man, his whole livelihood was a donkey. And the donkey died, and the gentleman had come along, and the word got back to Prof that the donkey had died. And he asked for the man to come from Augusttown to see him, and he presented him with an envelope. Prof never gave money into people's hands like that. He always treated them with a great deal of respect. He always put things in envelopes with their name on, Mr. So-and-so, Mrs. So-and-so, Mistress So-and-so, whatever.
multitude of people Professor helped, not only students, adults, everybody he helped. He helped the man who wanted to build his house, who wanted nails, zinc, lumber, brick, whatever format it comes in, there comes the fine Professor Nettleford. He helped the old man who is rearing his chickens, who want chicken feed, he would come to Professor Nettleford for money to buy feed. The students who cannot afford the school fee, Professor Nettleford is a father to millions of people.
I remember one day finding some funds when we were sorting through accounts before he moved across to the Vice Chancellery, and there were two accounts and we didn't know what on earth they were about. They had quite a lot of money in them. And we said, Prof, what are these accounts for? What should we do with them? He said, oh, when I would get money for an honorario if I'd been abroad, I put the money in these two accounts. One was to buy students food if they were doing rehearsals late at night at the Philip Sherlock Centre, and the other was for bus fares. And it's just little things like that he did all the time for people. He never, never, sometimes ever got any response or any thanks from some of these people. And yeah, it would hurt him like it would hurt anybody, that, but he'd never stopped giving because he said he got help.
I was living in Canada, attending Ryerson, and I was about to come home. And Professor Nettleford called me and said, look, there's going to be a school for communications, what was to become Caramac. And he suggested to me I should go to graduate school if I wanted to get a job at Caramac and to be not at the bottom of the rung at the university. But I left Toronto, went to graduate school in film at Northwestern University, came back to Jamaica with a Master of Arts degree, and there was no Caramac, no work for me. So what did I do? So here was I in Kingston on the Mona campus, no job, no Caramac, I didn't know what to do. Now, I want the whole world to know that Professor Nettleford and Professor Roy Auger called me and said, look, we're going to give you a job to do. We want you to make a film on the history of the University of the West Indies. So I traveled around the Caribbean to document what the university graduates had done, came back to Jamaica, finished the film, and still there was no Caramac. So Professor Nettleford said to me, why don't you form your own company? And that's how MediaMix was formed. He's the person who said, go out on your own and become an independent filmmaker.
One, two, three, four. And one.
He was very clear on what he wanted and very firm in that. So, but as a teacher, one of his greatest qualities would have been that he allowed you to be you. And so even though he was, yes, trying to, and nurturing, so he nurtured what exactly it was that he saw within you and trying to get the best of you. But yet, you know, you can be yourself.
As the regal maestro of the arts, Rex used the dance as a canvas with a paintbrush and a kaleidoscopic palette that allowed him to chronicle and celebrate the story of our lives for generations to come.
For purification to be one. making the journey of a lifetime.
Journey of a lifetime, journey of a life.
In silence I found peace, in loneliness I found love. Through war and peace I learned to fight, in darkness I came.
Certainly as a choreographer, I do not even believe in abstract dance. Abstraction in art for its own sake, for me, is a kind of indulgence, no more than I like raw naturalism, that you paint a portrait exactly how the person is. The photography does that much better, I think. Or you paint a tree exactly as it is. You have to invest it with some added dimension. Similarly, even if one starts with an abstraction, an idea, as I often do with dance, and in an attempt to find the vocabulary of a particular dance work, I struggle to distill the thing to its essences, but I've got to put it back together and invest it with meaning, relate it to human experience and to life.
The dance was much more than an art form. For him, it became a moving postcard with poignant footnotes and vivid pictures of life around him. In a Caribbean crucible contoured by class and race, Rex choreographed dances that forced us to examine ourselves in the mirror.
You're going to run out of that.
Professor Nettleford's vision of the company is what I think he has left. And he wanted the company to have a certain look, a Caribbean look. We shouldn't look like another company part of the world. And that is the legacy I think he left. And I think we have held on to that. Because we are a people of many mixed races and different ethnic backgrounds. That's where we are from, and that's what he tried to put on stage, you know, to show the world that we are a mixed people.
Professor Nettleford's use of the Caribbean vocabulary in dance, how he used the traditional forms to blend, to bring together that recognition of the form, something that is Caribbean. To me, that makes him more of the Caribbean person, his vision for Caribbean dance, how he has the way of using the material, of bringing, even as a dancer coming here for the first time, you know, my introduction into the Jamaican forms was very similar to what I had learned from my country Barbados and also from like maybe Trinidad. So there was a connection, a similarity that pulled it all together.
The history of the Caribbean is not the history of governors and houses of assembly and whatever. The real history, the history of the Caribbean is the history of the ordinary people who have made the Caribbean. It's a fundamental error which has been made and continues to be made by our political leaders who have chosen, wittingly or unwittingly, to ignore the collective wisdom of our ordinary people. And it is telling very badly on the failures, particularly since independence, in the pursuit of goals which are nicely put out in five-year plans and whatever, usually without consulting the people or using their experience and their achievements as point of reference. And when you come to think of it, anything that is Caribbean, definitively so, that have come out of the creative imagination have come out from the base of the society. That's why the Sparrows and the Lord Kitcheners, the Bob Marleys, the Cecil Bores are who they are, you see, because in fact that is the whole Rastafarian movement itself.
Prof was the ultimate Caribbean man. He saw everything in terms of Caribbean unity. We all being one, we all should be together as a unit. He saw this was his vision for UWE and for many, many other organizations within the Caribbean region. He didn't like the fragmentation into different groups, but he saw us all as the Caribbean. And he would be delighted if we'd all been linked together. Somebody was saying the other day, if we'd linked together, we could become the Caribbean states, we would win every single Olympics, hands down. That was Prof's idea. His whole philosophy was that we were all one. And that was all races too. Many people talk about Professor Nettleford's Africanness and his blackness, but he was for every single group in the Caribbean. He was for the Chinese, for the Indians, the Lebanese, every single group. He saw them all as Caribbean peoples.
Despite the fight, his shining star was aglow in the international arena where he was on show. His outward reach became a Caribbean embrace, never ashamed to celebrate the African race.
He did work in Namibia. He had good contacts with the universities in South Africa. Ifogona egayala,
Jamaica continues to produce sons and daughters who, because of their global achievements, settle comfortably among the stars. But there is one star that sparkles brighter than all the rest. This star is Professor the Honorable Ralston Milton Nettleford, a man for all seasons, if ever there was one.
I think the Jamaican eye is another aspect of the Jamaican feeling, the Jamaican sense, the Jamaican sensibility, something which I like to feel is shared by brothers and sisters all over the Caribbean who have gone through this peculiar history of 500 years of subjugation, of resistance, of survival, and beyond.
With famous faces, he could always relate to world leaders and heads of state. At home and abroad, they sought his advice. His primary concern was truth, not the price.
The King Must Die remains one of the signature works of Nettleford. The mortal remains of King Rex was returned to the dust from whence it came. But his long public service, his institution building, his soaring spirit, his creative genius and sheer academic brilliance form an epitaph etched in granite.
A prophet, they say, hath no honor in his own country. And I would say in Jamaica, sometimes when I look at it, I say, Prof hath no honor here. Nobody, you know, they doesn't see the value of the man. You know what I mean? The magnitude of Professor Nettleford. He's more respected abroad than in his own country. You know what I mean? There's so much I could say about it. I don't know where to begin. Tell you the honest truth. I don't know where to begin.
His legacy is not understood. And I'm concerned about that his legacy is being forgotten and his legacy is not being perpetuated, because his legacy was one of oneness, his legacy was one for education, his legacy was one for equality, and his legacy was certainly one of turning the other cheek, literally. And I don't see his legacy for what he established at the university. I do see his legacy continuing in the National Dance Theatre Company, because he honed that and was able to leave that at the stage when the youngsters have carried on just as he wanted them to carry on, in their own style, in their own ilk. But I feel as if he has been written out of the university.
If one were to ask me to describe Professor Nettleford, I would say he's a true son of Jamaica. He's a father to some, a brother to many, a mentor to legions, and a personal inspiration to me. Long live the King.
Like a sentinel still on guard, Prof's image will forever loom larger than life, reminding us all of his living legacy that will never fade into the sunset. Long live the King.
Dance on, King Rex. And you must know that in your shadow, we will always grow. Some will pay homage, and some will cry. But the country boy turned king will never die. Long live the King. Bless you.
Happy
Another production from Media Mix.